some of the riders that were bigger were performing great, and still they'd be like, yeah, but she needs to lose a bit of weight. And I'd be like, why? She's winning races, but you'd be in like the car with the director, and they'd be going like, oh, you know, so-and-so is looking a bit like little bit fat, and you're thinking, she just won.
This is Molly Weaver. From 2015 to 2018, she was racing in the pro peloton, a super domestique at the highest level of pro cycling. But what may look like a glamorous racing life from the outside was overshadowed by something dark, a problem that's deeply rooted in the culture of cycling that's not talked about enough. My friend Gareth and I decided to drive up to visit Molly, join her for a ride on her local roads, and listen to her story. Hey Molly.
All right.
All right. What's the loop you're taking us on today?
I call it the only easy loop that we have. It's like an hour recovery spin. Not that I even own a road bike, so this was requested.
Yeah, we've got a bit of an advantage here.
Yeah.
This.
Well, this was all glass, but that's all road rash, yeah. Then this is when I sit by the car, all this stuff. I've got an ugly ass one.
It's not such thing as an ugly scar, it's a storm.
Nah, they took the stitches out too early and it like exploded open.
This is the kind of thing that cyclists talk about.
I weirdly thought tattoos would draw less attention to it, they don't. I'm Molly Weaver, I used to be a professional cyclist, and I retired. Feels weird calling it because I'm still young. I retired kind of last year, really, officially, but I stopped racing professionally a couple of years ago.
Yeah. Being a professional cyclist, that's like a dream come true for most people. People like me like to pretend that they could have been a pro, but they never did.
Yeah.
How did your story start becoming a professional?
Kind of by accident. It was never like a dream because I started quite young, so you kind of get carried through the ranks in the UK. And then I went off to university and thought, oh, I'm not going to be a professional cyclist, I'll just race, you know, when I can in my free time. And then I got offered this professional contract over in Belgium with this British team. Like, a really nice guy was the manager, and he was taking all these young British riders with this vision of having a professional women's team that could break into that world. And I really liked that, and I thought, oh, it's kind of shoot your shot while you have it. I was young and I thought it's as good a time as any to take a risk and go for it. So I went for it and I loved it, and then just kind of went from there. Got offered like a better contract halfway through that year, actually. I got a promotion like mid-year, and then it kind of just went from there and just became my life, kind of organically and accidentally almost. But yeah, it was good while it lasted.
You went on to race for some of the biggest teams in the world. How did that feel to be good enough to race with those teams?
Kind of shocking at first, because it happened quicker than we anticipated. I kind of envisioned going with this team, staying with them for like probably more than a year, and kind of slowly progressing, because I'd never really raced internationally. I'd kind of raced in the UK and then bits in Belgium, and then the classics just went like better than any of us thought. It was kind of, we went from trying to just get round to being like in the front group and like, you know, being up there for like top tens and stuff in some of the big classics. And then I got this mid-season promotion, and that it kind of all spiraled very quickly. What was meant to be like a slow thing just went like bang. In half a year I was already off with Liv Planter that became Sunweb. So it kind of was like in at the deep end and a bit of like an education like on the bike. Then I was more going through the ranks, because you go from being on a tiny team, you're the best rider on a tiny team. Then you go to a big team and you're suddenly at the bottom of the pecking order, and you're like the rider who doesn't know what they're doing, and you're the least experienced again. So it's kind of within 1 year I went from being like riding the wave of, oh, I've become the like strongest rider in this, like unexpectedly. I was kind of riding that wave where everyone's feeding into your ego and your confidence and everyone's building you up. And then you move team 6 months later and you're suddenly like the least experienced, like weakest rider in that team. So then you have to kind of find your place there. And I became a domestique then, which I actually loved. I preferred that anyway. I wanted to be the best domestique in the world. That was kind of, I didn't really have much ambition to be the leader myself. That's what I liked doing. That's what I like thrived on. And we ended up having the team got better and better the years that I was there. So we started off kind of like a middling team, and by the end we were, you know, top three. And so it was nice to kind of grow with that your team leader became fighting for the top 10, then fighting for the podium, then fighting for the win. So you kind of went up with that. And you went from like, oh, let's try and get a stage win, to, okay, we're riding GC, you've got to be there with your rider in the finals. And it was kind of, we all grew together, and that was nice, yeah.
Molly's taken us on the muddiest ride she could find because she knew Gareth was coming on his nice bike, so.
Princess Gareth.
Our bikes are ruined.
Well, you didn't know about the countryside, is that was actually the cleanest ride I could take. Yeah.
When did you find that your career started to become more negative? And, you know, we're talking about the amazing success and being part of a team. Did you ever feel like you were alone within a team environment?
Oh yeah, I think the whole, you're only ever there for like a year or two, the way like contracts run and stuff, there's always that pressure that, you know, okay, I also have to do something for me, I have to perform in my own right. There's never, even as someone who claims to be, I was always happy to do a job for the team, you still have pressure on you to perform in a certain way to get a new contract. So there was always, sometimes it is either like me or her, like there is, and even though you can't race like that, that's always there, and you're thinking, okay, I have to like show that I'm stronger than this rider or someone else in another team or whatever it is, whichever kind of rung you're in, you have to be the best of that. So there's always that pressure, and everyone feels it, and you can tell that in training camps, as much as you're one team, everyone knows they have to also impress. So there's always that kind of, you know, thing of needing to be the best you can be. And I think it's easy for me to sit here and say all the great things and all the times that it was great and the teamwork was great and stuff, but that is just like the face of it. That was true though. It was great when you were in races and it was going well and you were winning, but there's all the other days and all the other time behind the scenes. That's a very small part of the year. So even if that's true, that doesn't tell the whole story of what happened in the lead up to that or what happened after that. And that's kind of where it was soured a bit for me.
Because you experienced something that I've dabbled with, and that was developing a negative relationship with food. Mm-hmm. When did that begin? How did that begin in your racing career?
On the first team I was on, I did have an issue with it, but it was more a lack of education and a lack of knowledge. So I went into that team and I kind of had this belief that I need to be as light as I can be. I need to be as light is better. So I was losing like a lot of weight, but it was never an eating disorder. It was just disordered eating. It wasn't that extreme, but it was one where I just believed, okay, if I'm lighter, I'll be better. It was like, for me, that was the correlation. So I was losing a lot of weight, and I went from the first few classics, I kind of got away with it. I was probably still a bit light, but I got away with it. I still had a strength and I wasn't too tired. And then probably around Flèche-Wallonne time was the first race that I thought, I'm just tired. Like, I'm really weak now. Like, I was getting like dropped on the climbs just because I was so weak and exhausted. But the team manager took me to one side, and with one of the older riders, they sat down and were like, you're too light, this isn't okay, and like, you're weighing your spinach and your lettuce and stuff, you shouldn't be like going down to that shouldn't be what it is, it should be more relaxed than that. And they kind of educated me, and like, there was no shame in it. I didn't feel that it was like a negative thing. It was just, okay, you're going about this the wrong way and maybe we need to teach you. So he very much put me with another rider who was a bit older and more experienced, and she kind of mentored me, and it went away. That was something where once I'd been taught and once I'd actually had someone like listen and try and make it better, it was kind of fixed. And then probably maybe a year later, maybe a year and a half, that's when I then got an eating disorder, which kind of, that was a very distinct like moment. It was like one day and that was it. It was from that day on I had one, and I think people think it sometimes is this thing where like it's a slow burn and it kind of niggles away. For me, it was literally, I just made one decision on one day, and from that day on, I think for like 2.5-3 years I had an eating disorder. Obviously you are like judged by how you look, from not just like the public, but like, oh, that she's looking big, and you're thinking, you know nothing about like me or my life. And I mean, you hear it all the time. I think it was an entire culture of the sport, and then I was on a team that was very, very into you being lighter. Like, it was like an all-encompassing thing, was that we needed to be lighter. And I don't remember often having any comments on training or fitness. It was all about losing weight. So you're already in this culture of a sport where every other article is about how you can lose weight. Every other person's talking about losing weight and getting leaner. And every person who sees a photo of you in a race is going like, oh, you look a bit big, oh, she's put on weight, or she's, even when a sprinter wins, it's like, oh, she's a bit bigger. So you're constantly kind of surrounded by this. And then if your daily life becomes all about you losing weight, and it's never fast enough and it's never enough. And although, okay, I do accept ultimate responsibility, I made those choices, I did things that I had the control over, but I think a lot of the time, especially in elite teams, you're set up to make those choices. You're kind of set up to fail. And I felt very let down by like the sport and the system and the culture of the sport, and it felt like you couldn't address it. It wasn't discussed. I mean, your weight was talked about non-stop, but always losing weight. Never anything else. Nothing else was mentioned. And I think if you're never losing it fast enough, and if you're never light enough, and it's every day, and it's all you think about all day, every day, and every time you go to a training camp, or every time you're looking around, you're thinking, oh, okay, I'm like looking bigger, or oh, they're going to weigh me, and I'm going to be over the weight, and then I'm going to get in, then I'm going to feel like crap, and they're going to tell me that I failed. And it's kind of, once that becomes your life, I mean, for me, it was, I knew I was going to miss a weigh-in. We had a training camp, and they said, oh, the nutritionist is coming, and you're going to get weighed, and I was like, oh, I'm going to miss the weight target, and I'd been losing it as quick as I wanted to, and I had it under control, and I felt that I was losing it how I thought was comfortable and safe, but I just thought, I'm going to miss it, and I just made a decision then that, cool, well, if I go make myself sick, I won't miss it, I'll make the weight limit. So I went and I made that decision, and then the next morning I made the weight limit, and I got the reinforcement of the praise and how great that was, and like I'd done it, and that was it. Then I'd been positively reinforced for doing it, and from then on it became then out of my control. It was then just, I couldn't control it and I couldn't not do it, and it was a coping mechanism, but it also felt like I was in control of it and I was making a decision, and I think it then consumes your life then.
It does take over your life.
Yeah.
Every decision you make, it becomes the leading factor to every decision you make is about food.
Yeah.
And when did you get to your lowest point? What was your lowest point when you decided, I can't live like this anymore?
I think once it becomes, like you say, it's already a part of your life, what you've eaten that day, when you can eat next, how hungry you are, like how hungry can I be and still get through the day and get through training and stuff.
Yeah.
For me, it was once I thought that I had then lost control. So when it was in the early days of it, it was like, okay, I'm only doing it like, you know, when I need to, or I'm only doing it so I can make the weight limit, and that's just the weight target, and that's just like a means to an end. And that felt, I think the fact that that felt like a considered objective choice, like, is an illustration of the issue, that felt to me like, oh, this is a choice that will have the outcome I need, that's getting the praise and that's meeting the target they want for me and that I want and that will feel good. And then it spiraled into, okay, it's now every day, and it's now controlling my life, and hiding it is the other part of my life, because it becomes quite difficult to hide. You're with people all the time, you're with teammates, or you're sharing rooms, or you live in a town with everyone else you know, and once it then becomes, I'm either doing it or I'm hiding it, and it's all that happens all day, every day, and I now can't get a hold of it, then that's when I was like, okay, I need to tell someone, and I need to do something, because I can't get myself out of this anymore.
When did you recognise that you had a problem and you needed to start putting steps in place to take control again?
I think once I moved to a new team, and then I think a lot of the time, and I think a reason I think this conversation needs to happen, is that once you have someone who you feel you can talk to, and it's non-judgmental, and once it becomes that we can talk about it, that's the beginning of the issue being solved. And I moved team, and I had a manager who I knew had struggled with an eating disorder in her career. So I felt like, okay, this is a safe place now. I'm not going to be judged for this, and I'm not going to be kind of either kicked off the team or taken out of races, or there's not going to be a punishment associated with this, which is how I always felt like, oh, it's dangerous to show weakness, because you'll then, it'll affect your career negatively. So never show weakness, never admit like failure, never admit that you've got a problem. So I moved to the team, and I thought, well, she's going to understand and she's going to get it, and it's not, and she'll help me. And so I told her, and that was, for me, was like the most pivotal step in all of it, was that there was someone who had been honest and open about it and had started the conversation, so I felt that I could continue it with her. And that was just a massive like turning point in my life, definitely.
How did it feel to finally tell like your parents?
Just a relief, actually. I thought it would, I didn't want to tell them, and it wasn't easy to tell them. And I think especially with family members, you feel like you're letting them down, you don't want them to worry about you, and I think I thought that it would make it more all-encompassing because they'd constantly be worrying and checking up on me, but actually it's just a weight off your shoulders, it's just a relief, and they were sad that it had happened, and they were sad for me that it had been so long that I'd been dealing with it, but that was the only thing they were sad about, was that I hadn't told them sooner. There was never any other, like, shame associated with it or any other judgment. It was all just, I wish you hadn't, like, gone through it alone. I wish you hadn't felt that you couldn't tell us. And it's not been an issue. Like, we discuss it if it feels like it needs to be discussed. And if I'm ever like, oh, I'm going to start taking some more exercise and maybe I'll lose a bit of weight, they're just like, okay, but let's be careful and let's, like, do it healthily. And so it's nice to have someone there who's looking out for your health and is more objective than you are about it.
It's kind of funny how if you're trapped in the cycling bubble, all you can focus on is your image, your weight and your performance. And outside of that bubble, people are worried about you.
Yeah.
Do you think anyone suspected you had a problem outside of the cycling world?
Oh, I doubt it. I don't think so. I think my parents knew something was wrong because you're not as good at lying as you think you are. You're not as good at hiding things as you think you are. But I don't think anyone knew specifically what it was. I think something that illustrates the issue is how people aren't shocked. If you hear like a teammate has an eating disorder, you're like, oh yeah, cool, that makes sense.
Yeah.
If you hear like another rider has one, you're just like, yep, yeah, makes sense. Yeah, I can see that. And it's like, we shouldn't just always be like, oh yeah, that seems like reasonable. It's like, how many people does it take for you to actually be shocked by it anymore? Like, no one's shocked by it because it's so prevalent that everyone just kind of goes, oh yeah, yeah, that does make sense. It's like, no, it shouldn't make sense. It shouldn't like add up. I mean, when I wrote the article, a lot of people reached out to me and it's difficult to be surprised. You'd kind of see them be like, oh yeah, you're like, you may be a bit more powerful rider, or you're a really lean rider. No, it didn't matter what like size of rider or type of rider you were. It's all, everyone who said it, I was like, oh yeah, like, oh, you were on that team and I know what like that manager's like, or like, oh no, you were in that racing like circuit, I know what that's like. It was just never shocking. And I think we kind of need to be shocked by it and need it to not be like, oh yeah, it's just part of the job or whatever. It's because it's not a reasonable kind of consequence, I don't think.
We have a real problem as that's a culture within our sport, is that you're you know, encouraged to be skinny and there's too much focus on being light and not enough focus on building healthy humans.
Yeah.
And I found when I realized that I was just too light, you know, I was 60 kilograms at my lightest, 178 centimeters. Yeah. People were telling me all the time, you look ill, you look skinny. Mm. And one day a coach came to my local cycling club and encouraged me to take an FTP test.
Yeah.
And I looked at my number at the end of it and I was just like, I'm so weak.
Yeah.
This number is half what it used to be 2 years ago. And as soon as I started training with power and took control of building power and building strength and needing fuel to enable me to get stronger, that's when I found myself again.
Yeah.
And that's when I was happy. And that's when I fell in love with cycling.
Yeah.
I started hating my bike. I was like, why am I going out cycling on an empty stomach? And as soon as I started training on a fueled stomach, I fell in love with it again.
I also think I always find it difficult to understand the obsession with it by, on certain teams it was worse than on others, but on teams even sometimes I was like, I've only got a year contract, I'm performing how like I'm expected to perform, why is this still any of your business kind of thing. And I always felt like, I think if it's a nutritionist, if it's someone who's educated and is coming at it from a point of trying to educate you and inform you and trying to get the best out of you performance wise, whether that's losing a little bit of weight, whether that's not.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some times of year we'd put on a bit for classics, sometimes we'd lose a bit, and that's fine. It's if it's in the context of you being healthy and the best athlete you can be. But I think when it becomes everybody's business to constantly talk about your weight, constantly be analysing it, constantly be telling you, oh, you know, you've not reached your target yet, oh, you're not on weight yet, oh, we need you to lose a bit of weight. I think at what point is it not your business anymore, and whose business is it? I think it's kind of, I don't think that just anyone should be commenting on people's weight all the time. It should be like professionals comment on it, and it's from a point of like health and happiness as well as from fitness. And they always say like happy bike riders perform better, and I always thought that was true. I always experienced that, and I think that kind of wasn't considered enough, that some of the riders that were bigger were performing great and still they'd be like, yeah, but she needs to lose a bit of weight. And I'd be like, why? She's winning races. But you'd be in like the car with a director and they'd be going like, oh, you know, so-and-so is looking a bit like little bit fat, and you're thinking, she just won, but it doesn't matter. All you've commented on is the fact she looked a bit fat. And I just think, well, is that any of your business? If she's happy, if she's healthy and she's winning, that's her business how well her career goes. And if it's going really well, then why are you still saying, because then everyone in that car is then like, oh, yeah, God, yeah, she's a bit fat. And then you're constantly internalising all of this feedback that's never, oh, she's looking a bit light. You never hear that. And I've been on teams with riders who are way too light, who are just weak. And still, we never heard anything about, like, nutrition from a positive point of view, from a, okay, we need to be healthy, and, like, there's such thing as being too light. You never heard that. It was always that there's such thing as being too heavy. There was never, you know, and it was, you wouldn't even have to be that big to be considered, for them to make a comment about, oh, she needs to lose a few kilos. And you'd be thinking, like, she's still, like, super lean and fit, but, okay, it was just kind of, you never had anything but the reinforcement that skinny was better, lighter was better. And eventually that plays on your mind, and it manifests itself as something like an eating disorder. It's kind of, I think at the moment it's inevitable, and I don't think that's right.
You missed a spot.
Oh, it's the story of my life, Francis. I miss a lot of things.
Can you do mine after?
I've already done yours.
You come first.
I know this is us helping. Kind of having these conversations is what's changing it, and I think the feedback from when I spoke out about it was, obviously, you never know how these things are going to go. You always think, okay, I'm, you know, I hope it goes well, but, you know, you don't know how people are going to respond to it in a culture that you're used to being very obsessed with being lighter. And I think in general there's a movement towards people having conversations like this, between people saying, okay, lighter isn't always better, stronger is better, and power to weight matters, but that's power to weight. Yeah. If you're getting to a point where you're losing all your power, well, there's no point. You're just getting lighter and lighter and lighter. There's no actual gain to that. And
that's what happened to me. I was getting lighter and lighter and lighter. I wanted to look like the archetype cyclist. I'm not even a professional. Yeah. Why am I doing this?
Yeah.
And I all I did was get lighter and weaker. And as soon as I started becoming stronger and leaner, then I felt great. I fell in love with cycling. And that just pulled me to a place now where I recognise... There's young people in my cycling club that have got the mindset of lighter is better. Mm. And we go on long rides and we get to a cafe and I say, can I get you a piece of cake or anything? And they said, no, yeah. Okay, I'm just going to have a protein shake when I get home.
Yeah.
And you're like, you've got a fuel, you're young.
Yeah.
Have you completely liberated yourself of the numbers and the control to live a happier life?
Yeah, I don't have like a Garmin or anything, and I don't have a training plan. And I don't have, but it's taken a long time. I mean, I still... Mm. I'm trying to kind of move away from every bike ride's training or it's nothing. Like, you know, it's a very difficult, I think when all cycling has been to is a job and very strict, and there's been like protocols and ways of doing things. And I think you have to kind of unlearn all these like behaviors, and you have to unlearn all of these things. And I think it's kind of a constant battle to get that balance right. But I also kind of felt that while I was in especially professional sport, you never kind of found yourself and who you were and your like autonomy and your own like thoughts and feelings and anything, because it was very much you were told how to think and how to feel and what was right and what was wrong. And I think that does have its place, but until you've actually learned who you are and how you want to do things and what's best for you, I think at the end of the day it's your body. And especially for people who aren't professional, I think there's constant judgment of people's bodies, especially in cycling. There's constant judgment based on weight and based on what people look like and how lean they are. I mean, that, even like as riders come into the sport, it's then already, it's all around you and it surrounds you. And I think it's not just when it's your profession. I think it's also the amount of people I see who are kind of amateurs, and the amount of people I had messages from once I wrote the article that kind of were people I thought, well, it's not even your job. Like, it's not even like this is something where you're like, oh, I'm not going to get a paycheck if I don't do X, Y, and Z. But it's just that it's still all around you. So of course it feeds into your life and it becomes an obsession. And then you lose sight of why you even rode a bike. Exactly. And the fact you ever enjoyed it, because it's not that anymore. It's a means to lose weight, or it's a means to do whatever. Because at a certain point for me, it became, oh yeah, I'll still train because I can like dehydrate myself and not eat, and I'll lose some weight and I'll be lighter. I can do my weigh-in after the... And it's like, it shouldn't be your only purpose of riding the bike is like, so I can get a better number on the scale than I would have in the morning and all this kind of stuff. And I think it's... You should be riding because you love it, and if you then like lose some weight or not, then great. If you put on weight because you put on muscle, great, but do what makes you happy and what you think's right for your own body and your own, and stop telling other people whether they should lose weight or not, because it's kind of, I just think it's none of our business what other people look like and how they feel happy and healthy and how they're at their best. It's not all about who can climb a vertical hill the fastest.
There might be riders watching this who feel like they might be going down a similar path to what you did. Mm-hmm. What advice would you give them?
Tell someone. I think open up to someone, whether that's me, like DM me, whether it's someone you know who's someone who's spoken out about it before, or it's someone you personally know, a parent, a sibling. My brother was one of the first people that I told, and again, that was someone who was in my life outside of cycling, who could be there and have no judgment. He had nothing to like gain or lose from judging me, and having someone who you think, okay, I can tell you, and you only care about my health and my happiness. And I just think it breaks the shame, actually, and it breaks the cycle, and suddenly you're accountable for it. When you're doing something in private and it's yours and it's very secretive, you feel like you can just continue to do that and it can go on endlessly because you're keeping it private. It's nothing to do with your life, and it's not affecting me, and it's nothing to do with my life outside of this moment. Where as soon as there's someone else knows about that and you feel like you're accountable for it and you feel like, you know, someone will know, suddenly it breaks that and it's now in your private life. So it's now, you know, it's now out in the open. And I think for me, that was a massive thing, was just telling someone, asking for help, saying like, I'm in trouble. For me, it was, I've lost control of this and I don't know what to do anymore. And then someone can either find help for you externally, or they can just be there and you can talk to them. And that in itself is like a massive step, because once you've told one as well, they won't shame you for it. If you have someone you trust who cares about you and loves you, then it's not going to be what you think it is. They're not going to hate you for it. They're not going to shame you. They're not going to judge you. It's going to be something where they want to help, and they can be more objective than you can be, because you can't be objective once you're in that situation.
Have you helped someone else? Has someone else reached out to you to share their experience because they know that you've been through something that they're going through? And how has that made you feel, if you feel like you've helped someone else by sharing your experience?
Yeah, I think when I spoke out about it, I kind of thought, oh, if one person even doesn't go down this road or speaks about it or talks about it or it opens up a conversation, then it was worth it. And actually, I ended up getting like so many messages from people, some of which I thought, yeah, I kind of knew, because, you know, people that you rode with, some people I raced with told me, and I had people on teams that I knew had eating disorders, and others you just thought, okay, I'm not surprised. And kind of that felt more like you could share in it, and suddenly you're like, I'm not alone. I'm not failing and everyone else is succeeding. And riders that, you know, I used to look at and go, oh my God, look how like lean they are, and they're finding this easy, and they seem like they've got such a healthy, like balanced life, and I'm here like struggling. Then it turns out they also were like, you know, off doing things that I didn't see that were also negative. So that helped me, and we could talk about it, and that helped them as well, because they're not alone, and oh God, it's not just me, and it's not that everyone else is succeeding and I'm failing. We're all kind of being failed and failing ourselves, and that's okay. We all have like faults, and that kind of, once you can take the blame off yourself and see it's okay, I made these choices, but I'm not gonna keep blaming and punishing myself. This is something that, you know, happens to other people, and actually we're also being failed by the system and the culture of it. And I had a lot of people, you know, at like lower levels who reached out to me and kind of said, oh, I've never told anyone before. And I think if you've never told anyone, then that first discussion, if you can have it with someone who either has spoken about it or you just know isn't someone who'd be judgmental, then you suddenly feel like, oh God, I'm not alone, and this isn't like some thing that I have to hide away in the corner and I have to be, you know, secretive about and ashamed about and carry that with me. Because it is, it's like, you'll also know, it's not that it's like one moment of your day, it's like your whole day. Yeah. And you think about it all the time, and actually it's like, you know, that kind of a problem shared is a problem halved. It really does, like, you suddenly aren't carrying around all that weight that comes with it, you know, for your all day every day. Someone else is like helping you with that, and yeah, I think a lot of people, a lot more than I thought, reached out to me from all different levels, and I think that kind of opened my eyes to the fact that it's not just professional cycling, it's from like the bottom up, and it's young people coming into it, and it's people much older coming, it's kind of all levels and all ages and all genders. It's an issue that's like way more prevalent than it needs to be.
Yeah.
So I wanted to quickly sign this video off with a big thank you to Molly and Gareth for talking about what is a very sensitive topic. While the events in the interview did take place a couple of years back, I think it's fair to say that the problem is still very real in pro cycling. And if you're watching this and feel like you're experiencing a similar problem, listen to what Molly said, open up to someone, and the more we can talk about this, the better. Thank you as always for watching, and I'll see you guys soon.